All right, Marilyn, it's all yours.
Good morning, everyone. So glad to see everybody today. And I am so thankful today that I have a roof over my head, that I have clothes on my back, and I got some food to eat, and I don't have corona. So things are going well, things are going good. I hope it's the same for you all. And I just thank you for joining us today. Welcome to Antioch Community Church, our Sunday service. We're going to have Holy Communion today. And I would like everybody to take a moment, if you're going to participate, to get your cracker and your juice. So just take a few seconds to do that. Is everybody back?
Yes, I believe everybody's back.
Okay, great. So today we're going to open with our song, and we're gonna have the real Twinkie Clark sing "God's Got a Blessing." Hey, Nedra, you know this Nedra song. Okay, Michael. I want to start with a song, I think. Amen, y'all. God's got a blessing with your name written on it. And now we're going to have the invocation. So if you would all bow in prayer with me. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come this morning thanking you for this day. God, we just thank you for everything that you've done and everything that you've given us. Lord God, sometimes we are just not always faithful in thanking you, but we thank you today. We thank you collectively. And we ask God that you would forgive us for those things that we have not repented for. God, we ask that you would cleanse our hearts today, God. Make us brand new, God. Help us, God, to be the people that you've called us to be. Heavenly Father, we ask for prayer for people all over the world. We ask for prayer, God, in the midst of this pandemic. We ask for prayer, God, in the midst of protests. God, we just ask you, God, to quell the violence. Lord God, we just ask you, God, that you would help us, God, to have change or to make change in the way things are done, and that we, God, would not be a brutal people, but God, we would be a people of peace in all arenas, in the police department, in the military, wherever we're called to be, God, that we would be people of peace. Heavenly Father, we ask, God, that you would give wisdom, God, to our leaders, because God, it seems like we don't have any leadership right now or any good leadership right now. So we're praying for good leadership, Heavenly Father. And God, we know, God, that even though we can't see you, we know that you're in control. And we thank you for that, oh God. We ask, God, that you would bless each family represented here. And God, we just thank you for the opportunity to hear your word. In the name of Jesus, we pray and ask it all. And amen. And thank you, Jesus.
All right, so more announcements. As you all know, today we have communion service today. So make sure you have your cracker, wafer, bread, whatever it is that you're going to use, and some juice ready as well. Wednesday night Bible study, we did not have it last Wednesday. I was unfortunately pulled into work. So we will continue where we left off at the end of the Assurance of Hope section in the study guide, and we'll start from there. As always, prayer requests. As you go through the service, if you have any prayer requests, you can wait to the end of the service if you like and place them in the chat window. You can do it in a private chat window to either myself or Pastor Marilyn, or you can do it in the public chat channel to everyone if you like. It's totally up to you. And don't forget your tithes and offerings at www.antioch.life/donate. It is available. I've not heard any problems or concerns about it as of this date, so that is all good. But if you do have questions about where your money is going or things of that nature, you can contact Gwen. If there's problems with technical problems in the site, contact Derek. WebEx problems, hopefully we got most of those resolved. If you still have WebEx problems, definitely I can spend some time either when you're available, we can work out some time, we can work out the WebEx problems, but I think we got most of them solved. For those who use the phone, I've been sending out a contact called Antioch Sunday Service, and you just save that contact, and you just click it, and it'll dial all the numbers, the passcode, and the access code, and all the pound symbols, all 32 numbers. They have to be put in. It'll do it for you automatically. And I'll make sure that gets out. And then again, I'll try to make sure we get a heads-up notice before the Sunday service starts so everybody has all the information they need to go in to join safely and quickly. And that's all the announcements I have for today.
Hey, I have a couple of things to share with you. So Dana got her wings. I don't think I mentioned that to you before. She got her pilot's wings when she was down there in Del Rio, Texas. And now she is moved to Little Rock, Arkansas. She has a place there. I think she's much happier there than in Del Rio, Texas, because in Del Rio, there was absolutely Nothing, not her favorite places to eat, like Little Rock. So she's doing well, and I says hello to everybody. And then also, I heard from Margaret and Bob, and they wanted me to tell you hello. They're doing well. They're staying close to home like everybody else is. And they just wanted to wish you well during this time. I think that's it for me. Okay, I'm going to move along now to our sermon and our scriptures. Mike, if you would bring up our scriptures, we're going to be in 2 Timothy 3, 10 and 11, 16 and 17, and chapter 4, 2 through 4. Okay, and so if you have your Bibles, you can read along, but you can also read along here as Mike has brought them up. And I'm going to start reading. The scriptures read as follows. You, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecutions, sufferings, what kind of things happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. The persecutions I endured, yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. And then 16 and 17, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. And then chapter 4, 2 through 4. I think I'm going to read 1 as well. It says, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. Let's just bow for just a moment of prayer again. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, and thank you for the word you've given me for your people. I thank you for your people today, and I thank you, God, for those hearts that are ready to hear your word. Lord, I just ask, God, that we be fertile ground for this, as we are in the midst of just turbulent times. But I thank you, God, God, that you are God of creation, God of all, and that nothing can come against you. So let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. As we have read in your hearing, we've read from the book of 2 Timothy, and this has been a good reading of God's word over the past several weeks. Today, our title is A Final Charge. A Final Charge. And this is part one. As we all know, we're amidst not just a pandemic, but protests and some violent protests around the world in the midst of the murder of George Floyd. I listened to his memorial service a few days ago and listened to Reverend Al Sharpton. And even though I'm not a fan, he brought that message, get off our necks, for all people, that the police, the government, whoever needs to get off our necks. And so I thought that he brought a poignant message for the time. You know, somebody recently said, God sometimes shouts with a megaphone. God sometimes shouts with a megaphone just to get our attention. So again, not only do we have the pandemic, which is continuing to rise, at least in 14 or 15 states, but we have the pandemic taking people, oh, by the thousands in places like Brazil. We have worldwide protests over that execution, as I stated previously, of George Floyd. I wonder now if there will be spikes of coronavirus because of the protests and people just so close together, not socially distancing, and many not wearing masks, not wearing face coverings. In this letter written by the Apostle Paul to Timothy in AD 67, there was widespread persecution of Christians. Today, we have widespread persecution of the people who are supposed to serve and protect. Two cops from Buffalo, New York, were charged with assault after shoving an older gentleman to the ground for really no good reason. We have a president that used active duty military against protesting citizens. His lack of leadership is evident in crises. On June 5th, the Pentagon told the National Guardsmen deployed to the nation's capital not to use firearms or ammunition, and has issued orders to send home active duty troops that the Trump administration amassed outside the city in recent days. This was a sign of de-escalation in the federal response to protests in the city. I have told you all in the past, there was widespread, again, persecution in Rome toward Christians, toward innocent people. Christians were torn apart by wild animals in Roman arenas as people gathered to watch. They were jailed in inhuman places. They were beheaded in the midst of crowds watching. They were doused in oil and set on fire in the Colosseum, the Roman Colosseum, and used as human torches. Talking about brutality, like we discussed last week, we are also in terrible times, as predicted by the Apostle Paul. Not to mention that Christians were perverting the gospel of Jesus Christ, preaching untruths about the death and resurrection of Christ, and taking people right along with them. So in let me see here in oh yes in 3 Timothy in chapter 8, the Apostle Paul called them men of depraved minds who, as far as the truth is concerned, are rejected. Again, when the Apostle Paul wrote to Timothy, he was in jail. And he wrote this right before he was beheaded in AD 67. So today, we're going to discuss the Apostle Paul's farewell message, because he knew he wouldn't be around to guide Timothy through the turbulence and through the people who were perverting the gospel. In this last chapter, last two chapters we'll talk about, of 2 Timothy, we have a letter, but not only to Timothy, but to every Christian that will come later, on how to live in the last days. Because as you all know, and as I've said in the past, we are living in the last days. So this would be important for Timothy to understand and to stand. Last week, we talked about standing out and stepping up in the midst of all the things that are going on. So my first point is that Paul said in this final charge is to remember your legacy. Remember your legacy. You know, we're going to see things get worse, maybe in our lifetime, but certainly after we are long gone from this world, things will get worse. But the Apostle Paul says to Timothy, he says, remember my legacy. You know what I've done. You know about my teaching. You know about my way of life. You know about my purpose, my faith, my patience, my love, my endurance, my persecutions, my sufferings. You know what's happened to me in Antioch, in all the places, all the persecutions I endured. So what I think the apostle is saying to us is, don't leave. Don't leave your children without your legacy. Remember, Timothy was like a son to him, a son in the ministry. Today, people write books and make videos when they know they're going to die. Your children, though, ought to know something about God and how he brought you out of some things. They ought to remember your teaching and your way, your patience and your love and endurance that set off the image of Christ in your life, that set off the image of Christ in your life. They ought to know the times you felt persecuted and the times you suffered. But most of all, they need to know how a great and awesome God rescued you from everything. How God worked it out for his good and according to his plan and purpose. We need to leave them with the truth, because when they reach a crossroads in their life, because God knows they will, they need to remember that God's word is critical, that all scripture comes from the breath of God and is useful for teaching, for rebuking, for correcting, and training in what's right, in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. You see, part of the legacy is to teach our children that the Bible is not just a collection of stories, not just fables or myths, fables or myths, or human ideas about God. The Holy Spirit, inspired by God the Father, revealed his person and plan to certain believers who wrote it down for his people. And you can refer to 1 Peter 1, 20 and 21. God's word is revealed to us. Although these believers may have spanned 1400 years, they all wrote what God wanted them to write from their own personal, historical, and cultural context. That's why Genesis reads differently from Daniel, but there's nothing in it that cannot help us to become wise. But there is everything in it that will help us to become godly. So we have to teach our children not to pay attention to what the world says, because you know, the world just wants to tell us that our Bible is just a book of stories that someone made up. But that is so far from the truth. Amen. It's God's word. It is God-breathed. They're not stories or myths. They are true stories. Like back when I told you the prophecy of Palm Sunday was back from years prior, at least 700 years prior, in a prophecy that Daniel made that came true on the very day that Jesus entered into Jerusalem. Our Bible is true. And it's not just a representation of God. It is God. My second point today is that the Apostle Paul told Timothy, preach the word, Timothy. Preach the word. Preach the word. It's part of that final charge to Timothy. Preach the word. Be prepared, in season, out of season, correct, rebuke, encourage with great patience and careful instruction. Preach the word, Timothy, no matter what's going on. Preach the word, Marilyn, no matter what's going on. Preach the word, all of you out there on the phone, because I'm just called to be the preacher in this context, but you are called to speak God's word in whatever context you are. Preach the word. When the waters are calm, preach the word. When they're raging, preach the word. Nothing in this world will stand against the word of God. Again, this is not just for me as a preacher of God's word in this arena, but for each and every one of us. We have to speak truth in love, as I have said on many occasions. But it's sad today that people are using expletive, believers using expletives in the same sentence with God's name. People want to live ungodly and do anything that promotes self and not God. And in fact, in the following verses that we didn't read, in verse 3, it says, for the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. Isn't that something? We see that all over the world today, not just in the United States, not just in America, which was began on Christian values. Many of our teachers are on Facebook and Twitter, Instagram, TED Talks, music, including so-called Christian music and podcasts. But many of the teachers are false and say what people want to hear to validate their own lifestyles. I can tell you from my own experience that preaching is difficult. You know, anyone can get up and say stuff, but to really bring God's word, to really bring God's word takes diligence, commitment, study, and a heart for God's people. We may be small, but you're going to hear truth at Antioch. So if you're not convicted by something I have said, I'm not a good teacher or a good preacher, and we're not a healthy church. One of the marks of a healthy, good church is that you hear the hard stuff that may convict you about your life. But the problem is, some of us hear the word, and then we don't show up for the next few Sundays until your feelings of conviction settle down. See, I gotcha. I know. Then some of you are dozing off during the sermon, so you never apply what you hear. I know. Because I can see. Now, I might not see you online, but I can see you when we're in the building. Some of us hear truth, and we go home, and we mull it over, and we wind up repenting and figuring out what we need to do to turn our lives around, to get on a straight path. Then we're right back the next Sunday, ready to learn again. And even though we know there'll be something else, a difficult circumstance, an unwise move, an argument in a family, an unexpected diagnosis, an unexpected death, we are right there, ready to absorb God's word, ready to repent, ready to forgive, ready to do what it takes to become a person who lives truth. Most of us have had one of these things, circumstances, that come up on a daily basis or periodically. But when we know that we're anchored in the Lord, you see, He'll protect, He'll guide, He'll comfort, He'll love you when no one else will, and He will calm every storm. You see, you just have to keep on keeping on during pandemics and protests. Remember that He's holding on to you and won't let go. We know that He will never leave us or forsake us. That word for leave means He won't fail. And the word for forsake means He won't abandon. You see, even though we can't see Him, we know He is there. And we know that we can trust that if God is for us, what can be against us? If God is on our side, He won't deny His children. I'm sure the turbulence in Timothy's life did not stop until he closed his eyes, but he held on in spite of. I'm sure many times, you see, he just had to lift his hands to the one who created everything, to the one who's faithful. Have you ever had to just lift your in because there's nothing else to do. I have. This is the final charge, part one. Today we've heard a lot. We've heard a lot about God's word and the final charge to Timothy, which becomes a final charge to all of God's people. And so I ask you today, have you heard the final charge? And what are you going to do with your life going forward? Have you heard the message? Have you heard the message about leaving your legacy? Have you heard the message about preaching God's word? Not necessarily that you're a preacher, that you're called for that, but that you are called to speak truth and to live truth. And so the doors of the church are now open. And we just ask you to come forward if you need prayer, if you need strength to be able to live this life, if there's something that's in your way, something that's preventing you from being all that you are, then you can certainly come forward and have us pray for you. We can pray for any other thing you're going on with health conditions, other issues. We just invite you to the altar at this point to pray. Will there be anyone? Will there be anyone? Well, Deacon Mike, would you go ahead? I don't see anything. Wait, let me look here.
I've been watching it, Marilyn. I have a
good.
Prayer request is starting to come in now. And I see
will there be anyone? Will there be anyone who needs prayer? Okay, Deacon Mike.
Okay. Let's all bow our heads. Gracious Lord, we are truly humbled, Lord God, by what we've seen and heard throughout the last few weeks and months, Lord God. And if it wasn't for you, Lord God, if it wasn't for the saving grace and mercy of our Savior Jesus Christ, of our Messiah, Lord, we would be overwhelmed right now, Lord. We'd be taken with the wave of sin and destruction, Lord God, and we'd be lost completely with no hope for the present and no hope for the future. But Lord God, you are faithful and true, and we have a greater hope than anyone could ever imagine, Lord God. And if you heard the word, Lord God, we know that we need to speak of the hope that you've given us, Lord God. We need to live the hope that you've given us, Lord God. And Father, we ask for that kind of strength right now, Lord God. We ask for the strength to live the way you've called us to live, to walk the way you call us to walk, Lord God, no matter what situation we're in, Lord God. Yes, Lord God, we're not all preachers or ministers, but we are your children. We are your ambassadors. We are your emissaries, Lord God. And you've called us for that reason alone. Not because we have great skills and do great things, but because we are your children. And we are here for you to spread your word, spread your hope, your faith, your love. And Lord God, we ask that you would help us to do that today, Lord, and every day from this day forward, Lord God. That a day doesn't go by that we're not constantly wondering, but when thinking and taking advantage of every situation we're in, Lord God, bad or good, it does not matter. It does not matter to your word, Lord God. And that's what we pray, Lord God. We pray for that kind of strength, that kind of courage, Lord God. And Lord, we pray for our members of our church family, Lord God. We all need strength through these times, Lord God. We all need to be focused, Lord God, on your word and not to stray away. Some of us stray away throughout the day, Lord God. Some of us stray away for weeks, months, moments. It does not matter, Lord God. We need that courageous, focused strength that only you can give us, Lord God. And Father, you've been good to each one of us, Lord God, in many ways. And so, Lord, we just continue to thank you for that, Lord God. We lift up, our brother Sam to you, Lord God, and ask that you would bless him, Lord God, and strengthen him, Lord God, as he seeks to understand the world around him, Lord God. Help him to realize that you are with him. You're always with him, Lord God. And that no matter what he faces, Lord God, no matter what he even thinks sometimes, Lord God, you are with him and you love him. And that he can choose to accept you and surrender to you at any given time, all the time, Lord God. You're always there for him. Lord God, each one of us wants to be on the path of righteousness always, Lord God. It is not an easy path. It hurts. We have to suffer. We have to fight. We have to struggle. Lord, help us not to struggle with our own strength, Lord God. Help us to lean on you only, depend on you only, Lord God. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Let's all say amen.
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 Amen. And here we have our song. I lift my hands.
His mercy is unfailing. His arms, a fortress for the weak. Let faith arise. Let faith arise. I lift my hands to believe again. You are my refuge. My refuge, you
Amen, y'all. Even in the midst of devastation, even in the midst of all that's going on, we serve a God who is faithful. And you ought to lift your hands and open your eyes and stand in faith, believing that God can do anything, anything but fail. And now it's time for the Lord's Supper, for communion. If you have prepared, we will begin with a word of prayer, blessing the elements that you're taking. Gracious Heavenly Father, God, we come in Jesus' name, just thanking you again for your word. Thanking you, God, that you are God over all creation. Thanking you, God, that you loved us enough to come, to live, to die, and to resurrect for all people, and to save believers from their sin. And so we thank you that we can now have a relationship with you. Lord God, that you have left us with this supper that symbolizes your last supper. We ask God that you would bless the bread, crackers that we will partake in. Bless the symbol of the wine that we will drink. Clear our hearts, God, from sin. Forgive us, God, for the things we've done, for the things we've said. Help us to be better people as we take this bread and this wine. May it encourage us, not just symbolically, but the taking of the bread and wine, may it just embody us supernaturally, and that you would do in us what seems to be impossible. Change our minds, change our hearts, Lord, to be more like you. In Jesus' name, I pray and ask it all. And amen. While they were eating, Jesus took bread. I'm reading from Matthew 26 in verse 26. Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." If you have your cracker ready, let us all eat. And then let us all drink together. Then I'm going to say the benediction, and then you all can get turned on your mics, and we will dismiss. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, again for this time. We ask, God, that you would bless us as we go our separate ways. We ask, God, that you would keep us safe in the midst of all the things that are going on. We ask, God, that you would continually bless our families and protect them. Now to him who's able to keep us from falling and present us before his throne without fault and with great joy, to the only wise God be glory, dominion, majesty, and power God, we thank you that you are that great shepherd of the sheep. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And let everyone say, amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much. Oh, thank you, Lord.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Marilyn.
You are welcome. Thank you all for being here. Thank you for being here. And I hope God has blessed you and continues to be good to you.
Amen.
Thank you, Tim.
You're welcome.
You said wipe your thank you.
Have a blessed week. I love you all.
I love y'all. Thank you for joining
Sam
us.
Day.
Hey, Tim.
Sam.
Hey, Sam.
Address.
Hey, y'all.
Have a blessed
How
week.
Y'all doing? Sam, how are you?
I miss seeing you all, but this is the second best thing we could be doing right now.
Yeah, it is. It is. We're gonna meet up soon. Hopefully in July. Hopefully.
Yeah.
I think that'll be the right time, but we'll do this through June.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And hopefully, even when we meet up, I'm trying to find a way that we can live stream at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
Oh, that would be great for us.
Yes.
Yeah, it would be. Anybody doing anything exciting?
I'm living.
Working out.
Living,
exercising. Exercising.
Hey, that's great, because that is one of my real struggles is exercise. I just give out.
Take your bike down, sister.
It is down, but sometimes my legs bother me so much I can't do it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So maybe I'll try today.